for coming. Today we're going to do an interaction looking at emotional connection.
With cameras rolling, researchers observe the connection between Selena Anderson and her three-month-old baby girl, Lauren. The connection from Selena to her baby, and from the baby to Selena.
Hey, big girl. Hey, mommy, big girl.
Just a few recorded minutes of this interaction will give researchers deep insight into the connection between Selena and her baby. That connection can dramatically impact the development of a child.
There's research to show that that babies and moms that are not connected with each other go on to have, that the babies go on to have problems in the course of their development.
I think having more of that.
Dr. Abby Lott, a clinical psychologist, is one of the co-directors of the Grady Trauma Project, a long-standing study of civilian trauma and post-traumatic stress disorder. Over the past 15 years, this female-led team of researchers have recruited over 12,000 people from the waiting rooms of Grady Memorial Hospital, a publicly funded hospital in downtown Atlanta.
Were health problems the primary thing that was...
What these researchers have discovered is that PTSD, most often associated with veterans of wars, is very much present in the lives of African-American women.
In the general population, 6 to 7% of individuals will go on to develop chronic PTSD following exposure to a traumatic event. In military cohorts, you know, PTSD has always traditionally been considered a problem for veterans. That rate of PTSD is closer to 30%. What work at GTP has really brought to the forefront is that civilian trauma exposure can increase risk for PTSD up to 46% of individuals that we've talked to have met for PTSD during their lifetime here at GTP. So general population, 7%, military population, 30%, and GTP population, 46%.
These are individuals who may be living throughout the Atlanta area, but generally come from more low socioeconomic communities, are experiencing significant levels of stress, trauma, racial discrimination, and have less access often to receive both physical and behavioral health care.
And are you right-handed or left-handed? Okay, so I'm just gonna scrub under your eye. Can you blink a couple times? Okay, and you can have a seat.
22-year-old Kayla Selmer is in what's known as the startle booth today, with Dr. Vass Michopoulos observing.
My research interests are really focused on trying to understand how stress and trauma essentially get under the skin biologically.
During this experiment, you'll hear some sudden tones and noises and see several colored shapes appear on the screen. So the tones are there to elicit startle and will occur every time something occurs. So some of the shapes will be followed by a blast of air and some will not.
One cardinal symptom of PTSD is hyperarousal.
Hyperarousal in someone with PTSD means they are more easily startled, for example, by loud noises. They might also be hypervigilant, constantly checking to make sure doors are locked or looking behind them. It can be hard for them to relax and settle down to feel safe.
Essentially, when you hear a loud sound, you physically startle, and one of those responses is that you blink your eyes.
We've got a respiration belt.
What we are measuring during the fear-potentiated startle is how robust of an eye blink response an individual responds to when they are presented with an aversive stimulus.
The aversive stimulus is that blast of air.
I jumped. And I kind of blinked like I was trying to get away from it. The air puffing in my face was scary. Was very scary when at the first time, and then I started understanding that it's a pattern that I had to go through.
Although Kayla learned the pattern and her startle response decreased once the air puff went away,
there's less ability to discriminate.
Someone with PTSD would show an exaggerated startle response, even when the aversive stimuli goes away, showing that their body has a hard time learning what is safe and when danger has passed.
We are all done.
Like most women in this study, Kayla, who has sickle cell and is 36 weeks pregnant with her first child, has endured significant trauma in her life.
In 2014, I had a stroke and lost 85% of my memory. I was not able to remember people, some words. I was back on a second grade level as a 15-year-old.
Among everyone we've talked to, most people have experienced at least four different types of traumatic events. We'll ask about whether they've ever been attacked with a weapon, attacked by a romantic partner. We ask if they've been through a major natural disaster or house fire, something of that nature. We ask people about whether they've ever been imprisoned.
I had to see my mom in prison. She did steal money from her job. So it was a lot of trauma there, is seeing her locked behind bars, not being able to come home with us most of the time, all the time. Missing out on birthdays and Christmases.
Selena has also suffered trauma.
I lost my cousin and his son to a home invasion. He was murdered in a home invasion. As a little girl coming up, I really didn't have my father all my life. So when he came into my life, it was like, no, I don't want him to leave me again.
I study the neural circuits that are affected by trauma, and I look at how the function of brain regions involved in responding to threat contributes to post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms. Today, we are scanning Ms. Shipman. And she is somebody who is a mom who came into the Grady Trauma Project. And what we're going to look at is the function of, in particular, a brain region called the amygdala, which is involved in a variety of different types of responses when somebody is confronted with a threat stimulus. The parts where we're actually sort of testing new hypotheses.
Neuroscientist Dr. Jenny Stevens says the threat stimulus is the sound of nails on a chalkboard. When this sound is played, the amygdala will activate the fight or flight response. But what happens next will help the study participants' brain adapt.
All right, for this next part, if you can look at the cross in the middle of the screen.
Researchers show her neutral images, not scary, while the noise is played again, and gradually her brain will learn the threat is no longer a threat. This is called fear extinction. It's similar to what happens with Kayla in the startle booth when she realizes that the stimulus paired with the blast of air is no longer threatening. The years of research at Grady Trauma Project have shown that the amount of trauma African American women are living with and the impact of PTSD puts them at a greater risk for a host of health issues, including cardiovascular disease and diabetes. And pregnant African American women are at even greater risk.
We know that Black pregnant women are at significantly higher risk for maternal morbidity and mortality. And a lot of the data that we've generated here at GTP shows that individuals, one reason that may be underlying that health disparity is the chronic trauma load and the experiences of chronic psychosocial stress that these women have been living with and been accumulated over time.
Exactly.
And you could hear her resilience.
What do you do with all this information?
The Grady Trauma Project team says women are impacted by PTSD at twice the rate of men, and biology could play a role.
And we think that there may be something special about the hormonal context for women versus men that might put women at greater risk for PTSD when a trauma comes along.
Estradiol, from the family of estrogen hormones, is being tested to see if it can help PTSD symptoms during times of month when a woman's estrogen levels are low.
Changing hospital-wide policy.
Dr. Abby Lott works with the women in the study to help mothers and mothers-to-be navigate the effects of stress and trauma and to reduce the intergenerational effects of trauma.
One of the things that we're doing at the Grady Trauma Project is trying to intervene as early as possible, specifically intervening with pregnant moms and helping to teach them mindfulness and emotion regulation skills to more effectively manage their own stress, anxiety, depression, so that they can be better parents and that it has more positive long-term effects on the child.
Dr. Lott also leads dialectical behavior therapy, or DBT, sessions with the women to help them cope with extreme or unstable emotions and harmful behaviors. Mindfulness-based approaches like DBT can be helpful to combat stress and improve how you manage your emotions. Without interventions and treatments, chronic trauma and stress load puts wear on their minds and body, impacting their health and longevity.
There's a pattern over time that's associated with aging. And what we see is that in people with PTSD, that pattern is accelerated so that their epigenetic age looks older than their actual chronological age.
The work of Grady Trauma Project researchers can have a generational impact. They took MRIs of the brains of mothers and their 9-year-old children, and what they discovered showed the power of good parenting.
We know that childhood trauma can impact the brain, but moms provide a buffer, and particularly moms who show warm parenting behaviors can help protect kids against some of the effects of early life stress.
Quite simply, the research is showing that when you help the mom, you help the child. The risk of negative outcomes for the child is greatly reduced. Teaching emotion regulation, mindfulness, to moms helps them to model and teach those skills to their kids, and that helps promote resilience. For thousands of women in the Grady Trauma Project, their PTSD was largely undiagnosed and unrecognized. These interventional treatments are often the first time anyone has asked these women what they've gone through in their lives.
But it helps me for someone to listen and me to cope and me to get through what I'm going through.
The work done by these moms gives them new tools to understand and navigate their feelings and how to cope with stress, helping them to be the kind of parent they want to be and to be present for their child.
I want to be one that is always there, always being supportive and giving my child my best and my all.
Since we first met Kayla, she has given birth to her son.
Kobe.
His full name is Kobe True Andre Miller, and it means a true warrior protected by God. I want him to have more.